To Raising Awareness for Happiness. This is a presentation to help you to become a leader in the happiness movement. My name is Laura Musikansky. I'm with the Happiness Alliance, and the lessons that you're going to learn here are based on work that we've been doing since 2010 in communities, in cities, in countries, in campuses, and with companies. So when you're raising awareness for your happiness initiative, you're going to ask, what's the purpose of raising awareness? Probably because you want to educate people, you want to inspire people, and you want to engage people. You're going to spend a lot of time educating people. And so there's lots of tools and resources at happycounts.org where you can learn about the happiness movement and learn lots and lots of facts. We're going to talk about some of the key points in this presentation later, but in terms of inspiring and engaging, you're going to have something that you want to tell people to do. And what you're going to probably want to tell them to do is to take the happiness index. So you want to let people know that happiness is important, that happiness can be measured, and that you can take the happiness index. And that's the key thing. Go to happycounts.org to take the happiness index. So you're going to want to say your website or wherever it is that you're going to direct people to take your version of the happiness index, which you can get from happycounts.org. All right, so let's talk about some of the different models for raising awareness. So there's events, giving talks, and I'm going to talk about some of the key lessons around that. So raising awareness with events. So you might want to do a movie screening. There's some really great movies out there that will really inspire people to start thinking about the happiness movement. The story of solutions, like the story of Stuff by Annie, is really, really great. And then there's a movie called Happy, which if you haven't seen it, it's a wonderful movie about the happiness movement, and it really gets the point. Where to Invade Next has an unfortunate title, but it actually has a lot of information about the different policies that really help to contribute to happiness and well-being in different countries. And Inequality for All is talking about the problem, so it's more of a negative orientation. But I would suggest that the top movie would be Happy. Then you want to follow your screening with talks and discussions. Now, your screening may be in your living room with a few people, or it may be in a town hall. Either one. You want to follow it with talks and discussions. And here are a few discussion points that you can have people to give people just before they watch a film, and then prompts for when you're done with the film and ready to start the discussion. Do end your event with a clear request. Take the happiness index and then tell them where your website is, because you want to gather that happiness data. You might want to give some talks. You can use the information in these presentations and lots on happycounts.org to give talks. If you love to give talks, then talking about happiness is very popular. You can give talks to all kinds of different events, or you might want to bring somebody in to give a talk. So you can bring in authors or academics or politicians, and you'll want to draw in the audience and engage them to get involved in this paradigmatic shift to a happiness and well-being based world. So town halls can be great ways to give talks. They can really help to give your project respectability and bring a lot of attention. But you might want to just give talks in smaller venues too. And then you can do a TEDx style events. People really like TEDx style events, and they're quite popular now, and people get them. So you want to be careful not to call it a TED event, but you can call it a TEDx style event, or you can call it a, give your own kind of name to it. So some other ways to raise awareness. Maria Chamorro has got started early in the happiness movement with his Happy Post-it project. It was quite beautiful what he did. He would get people to write what makes them happy and make these beautiful displays, and then they would pull all of the data from there and create these reports that were based on the one thing or the things that people wrote that make them happy. People love this kind of thing because they're bright and they're embodied. They can write something down and they can contribute to a collage. So that's a really fun way to raise events. And then libraries sometimes will put on book themes and create different different ways that people can engage. So that's another way that you can raise awareness. Here's a few books, and there are many, 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 many books on happiness out there. But these are some of the ones that are very focused on the happiness and well-being movement and that shift, and give some good resources and some tools for personal happiness and also for systems change. So posters and pamphlets, you can make some nice posters and pamphlets and hand them out. Make sure that if you direct people to your website, that you have a very easy to remember website, very simple, no long phrases or anything like that in your URL. Okay, so if you're going to give a happiness talk, I want to give you a couple of openers. When people come to listen to happiness talk, they want to think about their own happiness. They may be interested in social change, but they definitely want to think about their own happiness. So you want to begin with some kind of fun exercise. This is something that I often do, which is I start with the 10 things that make you happy in 30 seconds. So get people with a piece of paper and a pencil and give them 30 seconds and tell them they're going to have 10 things to write about. 10, see if they can find 10 people, 10 people, 10 activities, and 10 things that make them happy, and see what, then you can start your discussion from there. Or you can get people to put their hands up and then just start with a closed fist, and for each finger, you know, see if they can list them up. That's a fun way to do things too if you don't have pencil and paper. So for example, right now, close your fists and you're going to have 30 seconds and list 10 people who make you happy. And so, you know, lift your finger or your thumb for each person. So let's just say your mom, your dad, your child, whatever it is. Or maybe not. Okay, so then we will move on to another practice, which is the gratitude practice. So you can wrap this 10 things up with showing that this is a gratitude practice, or you can also show some other gratitude practices, ask people if they do journals or post things on Facebook or another social media, and or write gratitude letters. There are different books out there. Seligman and Sonia Lubominsky have written them about gratitude practices that you can learn from, and you can talk about these. If you give a talk and it's interactive and you ask people, somebody in your audience will have one of these gratitude practices and can talk about it, and then you can share about that in your talk. You can talk about generosity. These are the three things, if you remember from our presentation on who, what, when, where, how. These are the three main things. There's lots of different lessons from positive psychology, but the three main things are mindfulness, generosity, and gratitude. So generosity exercise would be to ask people how they give and what are some of their giving practices, and then you would want to back this up with some of the scientific findings that there's a hierarchy of giving in terms of what gives you the longest lasting happiness. So if you give somebody a thing, they get a little burst of happiness. If you give them experience, they get a longer lasting sense of happiness. And if you donate for somebody to a cause that they believe in, even if it's a cause that they don't believe in, then they actually often get a longer, on reflection over time, they get a longer sense of happiness from that gift. So that's a little bit of the science that you can back up, but you learn about this as you learn more about the happiness. And then when you wrap this up about giving and you have a presentation where you're starting off, your talk where you're starting off, you can reframe giving in that a person, when they're giving, a gift can be just taking the time to look somebody in the eyes and smile, or taking the time to say something loving and kind. And you can pause and ask people to pair up and ask them to say something kind to each other, just to look somebody in the eyes and just to say something kind to each other, to have that experience of giving. So those are some of the openers. Another way that you can open, and this is sort of like what a lot of TED Talks styles do, is open with a personal story. And when you tell your story about how you got into the happiness movement or your journey to happiness, because people will ask you, you know, are you happy, and you'll want to be able to talk about that, then you inspire others to talk about their stories. So here are some prompts about for you to in telling your story, but that's another nice way to open. All right, so next we'll go on to a few key points for messaging about happiness. So these are some of the key and core points about scientific findings in the happiness movement. So the first is the Easterlin paradox. So you can ask people, who here has heard about the Easterlin paradox? And usually somebody has, and maybe they'll get it wrong. Don't shame them. Just say yes and then move on. So Richard Easterlin is a researcher who did longitudinal studies, and this is across all nations around the globe, all over the world. And he found that up to a certain point, people, as their money, as their income increases, their portion of the gross domestic product increases, their happiness actually increases quite a bit, up to a certain point. And then after that, their increases are marginal, and then after a certain point, they're so small. So, for example, if you in the U.S. that Easterlin number is about 75K, and this varies, it may be less for some people. Certainly, for the most part, it isn't more. It's a lifestyle choice, which can be a hard point to bring across. But after 75K, to get the same boost of happiness, you have to keep increasing your salary by more and more and more to get a boost in happiness. And then after a certain point, you actually start to get diminishing returns to the point that more money just isn't going to make you happier. So this is a really important lesson. This is backed up by lots of research, and here are some of the sources for that research with Layard and Easterlin. And there's a caveat to this, which is that in the short term or in a recovering economy, money does boost your happiness. So let's just say that you are quite wealthy and you are given $100 or $200 or $10,000, you're going to be a lot happier. Say you win the lottery, you're going to be a lot happier for a little while. But then you'll return back to your state that you were before. So what do you think? You can ask people, what do they think? When has money made you happy? And when have you been happy without money? And there's a lot of wisdom that can come out of these questions. So let's move on to the next key point. We have two more key points. So the next key point is about gross domestic product, the sum of all goods and services produced in a year, and what does it count and what doesn't it count? And so you can do this as an exercise if you have a classroom or you have a group that you can do an exercise with, when you can ask them in their own personal, if they just think about their household as a nation that has its gross domestic product, what is it that's happening in their household that counts towards their little country's gross domestic product that is good, and what is it that is not good for the household? And what is it that's happening that doesn't count? So we know that certain things that don't count towards GDP are very important. And there's this beautiful speech that Robert Kennedy wrote that is fun to have people read. Sometimes when I'm giving talks, I'll have one person read a sentence. So you go around the room and each person reads one sentence. But the gist of it is that GDP measures everything in short except that which makes life worthwhile, which brings us back to the whole point of the happiness movement, that happiness is the purpose of life and the purpose of government, which we talked about in the who, what, when, where, why, how of the happiness movement presentation. All right, so there's some good information from Wealth Inequality in America with some nice graphics that show about inequality and where our focus on GDP has brought about inequality. That's a website that you can go to. And then also the Stiglitz Senin Fattoussi report, the report by the Commission on the Measurement of Economic Performance and Social Progress, has also got good information, although it's a little less accessible. It's written more for the policymakers and the academics about why GDP is not a sufficient measure for governments. So one of the problems that we're having right now is the lack of sustainable development with our focus on economic growth. And we know that right now, for the most part, people in what we call the wealthier nations are using more resources than we have if everybody were to use the same resources. So that's another problem with GDP that you can bring around. Although oftentimes if you focus on that, It can get people sort of derive getting them a bit off point. So you just bring that up and then bring it back to refocusing on a new economic paradigm and why it's so important to change our measurements for success and why it's so important to rethink things. So let's go to the last key point now, which is why would we measure happiness? And this is just very to the point, which is that happiness is the purpose of government. Happiness metrics are the means for us to make happy, one of the means for us to transform happiness as the purpose of government. Happiness metrics, they capture the unobservable, they gather information about perceptions, which are very important because that is what motivates decisions and actions. And that is what's really important, is your perceptions. Just the facts is not how we live our lives. We live our lives based on how we're feeling and how we're perceiving things. And then happiness data reveals granularity and it defines issues. So issues of social justice, issues of sustainable development in terms of how we are living our lives. That's where we can really get some good information instead of overall averages for objective data. And then with happiness data, you are the data. So when you take that survey, when your neighbor takes that survey, when your brothers and sisters take that survey, you are the data. So it's inclusive. So happiness data can be used to guide societies towards desirable futures and then to check to see if we're actually doing that, if these are the desirable futures that people want to arrive at. And this quote is from Wellbeing for Public Policy by Diener Hellawell and other authors, one of my favorite books in the happiness movement. So that's a little bit about how to raise awareness. There were lots and lots of tools and resources in this presentation. There's lots more at happycounts.org. I urge you to get the Happiness Policy Handbook that has a lot of information about raising awareness, as well as lots of other tools and resources, and go to happycounts.org, where you'll find other tools, and to donate to the Happiness Alliance. This presentation is copyright the Happiness Alliance, as is this video. So please contact happycounts.org, info@happycounts.org, or you can contact me, Laura@happycounts.org, if you want to use it. Thank you.